Hey, it's Fran again, and I thought I would start my camera and do a little video because it's first day of spring and time to do some spring maintenance. And one of the things on my list is my jukebox, because around the fall it started to crap out on me. The left channel stopped working, and so I haven't really used it all winter. And I'm really anxious to play it again, so I thought I'd crack it open and pull the amp out. And so I think it's going to be a pretty quick repair. It's an intermittent problem, so I think it's probably either an oxidized connection or a cracked solder joint or something. But it gave me an opportunity to show you the jukebox inside and out, because I've always been a big fan of jukeboxes, and this is an AMI-Rowe R-88, and it is one of the very last of the all 45 jukeboxes. The next generation that came out after this was were hybrids that had CDs and 45s. This was made in the early 80s, I think around 82, 83, 84, I'm not really sure. But it's definitely one of the very last. It's a 200 play, that means 100 records, two sides. And I've done some modifications in here and maintenance over the years. I completely rebuilt the mechanism when I got the jukebox, because it really didn't work. back in 2000-ish, I guess it was. And I made my own template, too, for the cards, for the little labels, because one of the things that really makes a jukebox distinctive is the having the labels be kind of appropriate for the records. And I've made a template many years ago that I've made all the labels up with various color schemes for different eras. So in the 50s labels are sort of salmon and light red or kind of gold. The 60s ones, 60s labels are, you know, have sort of a pink background with red or lavender or teal and gold. And the 70s ones and 80s ones are sort of a mix of blue and green. And, you know, I just kind of made them all different. There are a few that are kind of unique. One of them is the Hives record for Walk Idiot Walk. That's in black and white, and it's the only one in here in black and white because it's a white vinyl record with a black and white label. It was actually given to me by Vigilante Karlstrom of the Hives many years ago. So that actually is the only one with a black and white label. I also took some liberties like the Monks, I Want the Right to Be Free and Don't Ha Ha. Well, it's actually a Dave Day record. It was given to me by Buddy Woodward, who actually got it from Dave Day when they did the K-Stomp in 1999 in New York. It's a really big deal. And Gary Berger is also on that record, so I figure it's a Monks record. It's like whenever Roger Daltrey and Pete Townsend play, it's The Who. And so as far as I'm concerned, whenever Gary Berger and Dave Day did a record, it's a Monks record. Anyway, let's open it up and take a look on the inside. So, probably going to be some buzzing on the mics here from the fluorescent lights, but this is the inside, and you actually change out the labels by pulling down. There's two tabs that release the label marquee, and it comes down. The labels, they slide out sideways-ish, like so. You know, they kind of slide out. Makes it easy to change them in and out. And this is the mechanism with the carousel. The AMI was really famous for having this kind of carousel, and in the early designs, the really famous ones from the 60s, like the Continental, actually had like a window or a bubble that would show the carousel prominently on the top, where you could see the mechanism running and stuff. I really miss that about the later jukeboxes from the 70s and 80s. They began to enclose the mechanism and hide it, and I think that was really a shame, because I think one of the things that really killed the jukebox was hiding the mechanism, because it really was the cool thing about watching it work and watching the carousel go around. It has a couple different modes. There's playing mode and a service mode. So if I put in the service mode, it allows me to change the carousel. I can turn it around, change the records and such. Pull one out at random here. Mind Rocker by the American Breed. Oh, Bend Me, Shape Me. So one of the things about the records that have been in jukeboxes is they do have the telltale little swept scratches on the edges from going in and out of the mechanism. And whenever I buy records, I can always tell if it's spent any time in a jukebox by looking at the very edge and looking for those little telltale scratches that show that it's gone in and out of the mechanism. It doesn't actually change the playability of the record because the 45s are designed with a raised lip on the outside simply because they're really made for jukeboxes, and the raised lip protects the actual groove from any scratches while it's going in and out of the mechanism. One of the other things about the AMI is that the tone arm is actually on the opposite side, and the cartridge is actually turned around. It faces the opposite direction. The stylus is actually closer to the pivot point than a regular turntable. It's kind of interesting why they did that. I think they put the tone arm on the left side for skating, to be like anti-skating, because it seems that with the record turning towards the stylus rather than away from the stylus, it's a lot less prone to skip and bounce around when the turntable is jarred, and I think that's the reason that they did it. The entire mechanism is on four really large springs, and it's all shock mounted, so it does have some wobble to it. Although, to be honest, if you bump the jukebox while it's actually playing, it'll skip pretty easily, even with all of that. Now, my jukebox, this jukebox actually has a computer in it. The earlier jukeboxes were all electromechanical, and the jukeboxes from the 60s and the early 70s, the selection memory and such was all done electromechanically with little pins and such that would be pressed in when you make a selection, and those pins would remain and be reset as the carousel would go around, so it would remember which selections were done. But this actually has what a central control computer, a really great little computer which allows the machine not only to remember the selections, but you can choose how it plays back. It'll play either linearly, that is, it'll choose the selections in the order that they are in the carousel, which reduces the carousel wear and reduces the wear and tear on the records, or you can choose for it to play in the order selected. So it'll play the selections in the order that you actually put them in, not the order that they are actually in the machine. But it has some basic controls. You can clear the memory, you can add credits, although I've got this on free play, so I never use that. It has a playmaker mode, which will actually just randomly pick songs. So like if you wanted to just play randomly, you can choose how long you want it to play, and it'll just randomly select records. Pretty cool. It hasn't really let me down. I have to pull on the connectors every now and then because they do tend to get a little oxidized, which is why I think the same thing has happened in the amplifier. This is the case for the actual amplifier itself. And I've actually modified it with this little external pot here. There's a volume control, but it's mounted on the back of the machine, which is up against the wall. And it's really a pain to have to roll the machine out and get your arm back there to adjust it. And it's actually really, I can't get to it anymore. So I put a little 10K pot here on the inside. It's just in parallel with the other one, so I can change the volume from here. And I just have the other one turned up a little bit, so it gives me a little bit of control. All right, let's take a look inside. And this is the amp and the power supply. Power supply is back in here. It's a linear supply. Three huge transformers. It's pretty loud. It's basically, it's a regulated supply, puts out plus 8 volts for the controller, and there's a also a 28-volt AC line and a 28-volt DC line regulated for the power supply. And this is the power amp here. The power amp, it's stereo. It's got controls for the bass and the treble and the balance. And I found that when I was when playing the jukebox, that if I pushed on the switches are all mounted on circuit board on the inside, and if I pushed on the switches on the right side, the left channel would come on. So I'm pretty sure it's either a bad connection between the boards or a crack solder joint in there somewhere. But I have to get to the back of it, I have to take the whole amp out, which it's going to be not too hard at all. It's kind of designed to be taken apart. So there are a few Molex cables here. This is the speakers, left and right. That one there, that's for the audio in from the cartridge, the phono. So it should just be a simple matter of just pulling these plugs, lifting the amp up off of the supports, and pulling it out. Although, I have a feeling this amp is probably very heavy. But once we get it out, we can take a look at it. A little handy crowbar to get it unlodged underneath the heatsink. Someone's put a screw in there. That'll do it. All right, always look for the screw. All right, let's try this again. All right. Is out. Ta-da! This is it. This is the amp. So here it is. 130-watt stereo amplifier. Big heat sink with all of the transistors covered in there. It's got a dust cover on the top. Yeah. A whole bank of them in there. Big transformer. Lots of iron and copper, to be sure. Turn it this way here. There we go. There we go. And these are the basic controls. You can run it mono or stereo. You can adjust the stereo balance. There's 4 speakers in the jukebox. 2 mid tweeters and 2 woofers. 2 pairs. It's got the music level during paging. That's kind of interesting. I don't think I've ever used that. There's also microphone input. This has a lot more options than I was aware of for the jukebox. Look at this, you can actually put up the music level during paging. This must be for use in offices and stuff. They did have versions of this system that didn't come in this kind of jukebox case, but that it would come in like an enclosed like cabinet. They were used for offices and such, where you could put records in there to play Muzak in offices. This is long before you had the Muzak on the radio. And some of those systems were hooked up with, in offices with paging and such. This is probably for that, because you can adjust the music level during paging. Would definitely be that kind of an option where the music would go down if you got on the mic and said, you know, so-and-so come to the office. So that's pretty interesting. Be interesting to hack into that and use it. But you've got 2 separate controls for, you got a bass boost and a treble range. The bass boost helps a lot in larger rooms where you can up the bass a lot. I've got it kind of in the middle. And the treble, obviously, you know, again, depending on the size of the room and where it's located, you can up and down the treble in 3 different settings. I find that the jukebox sounds best if it's actually in a corner of a room. It's just sort of designed to project out of a corner. If you've got in the middle of the room, it sounds pretty flat. but it should be up against the wall at least to project outwards into the room. So that's pretty much in the front. You've got the overload indicators for clipping, which is pretty cool. So let's take a look at the back. This is the back. This is what I'm talking about, the two different circuit boards. There's obviously a left and right channel for the preamps, and then this board here is for the controls. And I think the issue is actually where this board connects to the other board. There are pins that connect the two boards and register here, and I think this is actually where the problem is. It doesn't look too bad. But there are all these pin connectors here, lots of them. So I'm probably going to pull all these, hit them with some deoxit. If you got a switch or a potentiometer that's noisy, it's just not working anymore. Usually just a shot of this and a few turns of the pot or a few works of the switches, and it's really good as new. I use it all the time. I'm going to pull out this backboard. It's got some of these plastic latch pins that I'm going to have to undo. Out. Okay, so here's the board, and got a 4739 CPs. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 of them. So they're making up the EQ. It's also a little relay here. It's interesting. That must be for the muting. A little reed relay. I'm going to clean out the switches, clean out the pots. Indispensable tool for this is a regular old toothbrush. So going to spray some deoxid into it and use it to clean off the contacts. Should do a great deal for the connectors here. And on the back end too. I do see a lot of tarnishing on these. It could very well be that this is actually where the problem's coming from, because when I pushed on the board, I can see a lot of oxidation on these pins. This is probably where the problem is right here. Oxidation. I'm sure that when they designed this, they had no intention that this thing would be in service for 30 years. But they did design them to be serviceable and modular, so all these boards, they can all be yanked out and replaced with another board. These pins are bent. The idea is I use the toothbrush to get the deoxid onto the pins, and then when you put the socket back on, just kind of give it a wiggle and it'll, clean off both ends. All right, I'm going to deox all these switches. Just get a little shot on the side. Yep. Off the switches. And such. Gotta remember the settings. This is also the little sticker here. It says, last tested on December 9th, 1986 by Brandt. So Brandt said, tested okay. Get a little shot on the potentiometers. Alrighty. Alright, give it a look on the back here. Once over with a magnifier. Pins. Looking for cracks where the pins are mounted, or stress points on the switches. Looks really good. I'm willing to bet that it probably will work. Those pins were really, really oxidized, so I'm willing to wager that the issue is actually these pins here, where it actually connects in. Because when I pushed on the right side of the board, it would come on, so I think it was just the shift tilting of the board on these pins up here. So clean those off. So I'm going to stick it back together and fire it up and see if it works. All right, it's all back together again. So let's see if it works. Now, I would love to go through my jukebox records and play them on my YouTube channel, but unfortunately, Google would stomp on it right away. Because these are all A-sides. But I do have that Dave Day record in here, which is a little obscure. No one's really heard about it, and I know Google isn't going to quarantine my video. So I'll show you how this works by playing Dave Day's great song, I Want the Right to Be Free.
One, two, three, five! La 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 la.
And it works. Yep. Well, that's the end of this one. So, I'm Fran. Bye.